Mr. Camacho, thank you very much for coming down today. And if you could you introduce yourself and tell us what your role was in the trial of Kent Hovind, a.k.a. Dr. Dino?
Okay. Again, my name is Don Camacho. I was a member of jury number four in the trial. I was the jury foreman.
And is the jury foreman position chosen by the other jurors, or how does that work?
Yes, it was. At the end of the trial, one of our first items was to select a jury foreman.
And when you say jury number four, what's that mean?
It was the...
some court designation?
Yeah, well, I was in the first role, the fourth position.
Oh, okay, got it. And when you got called for jury duty, did you know what trial it was for?
I did not. I was interested in the trial because I had read some articles in the paper where he was coming up for trial.
Kent Hovind?
Yes. And it was some issue on property. Didn't exactly know why. I was not very familiar with his first case, the tax evasion thing. I didn't know anything about that. But I had the summons, and I knew it was a federal trial. I didn't realize it was his trial until I actually showed up at the court. Well, when we walked in the room, actually.
Right. Oh, that must have been a little shocking. Was this the first time you did jury duty?
No, it's not. It's first time in a while since federal, but no, I've done jury duty before as a foreman.
Oh, excellent. Yeah. Tell us a bit about yourself. What's your background?
I'm a retired Navy officer. I spent 24 years in the Navy. I'm from Gilroy, California.
The garlic capital of the world.
I retired in 1985. I married a young lady from area called Bratt, which is on the Alabama-Florida line, back in 1964. We've been married going on 52 years. So we decided to drop the anchor here, so to speak, in 1985.
And although you're retired, are you keeping busy?
I am. Still working.
What sorts of things do you do?
I worked several years in the aviation business here in Pensacola. Worked for Lockheed Aircraft, taught at PJC, A&P Mechanic School. I currently working for a mental health service that a large company, part of Baptist Healthcare here in Pensacola. Been with them now almost 12 years.
So do you feel like you know Pensacola and you have some sort of roots here?
Yeah, I've been here now 30 years, and really born and raised in Gilroy. I left there when I was 17 and joined the Navy. I was a sophomore in high school and was much smarter than anybody else and decided I needed to go to Vietnam. So,
brilliant.
Yeah, with some of my brilliant stuff, right. The brilliant years. Yeah.
So, I'm an outsider, I'm from Boston.
Right.
But is it fair to say that Pensacola's three cities, it's the Navy, it's the beach, and it's the city proper? Divvy it up that way?
Yeah, but Navy certainly is a large part of Pensacola. Of course, this used to be a large aviation repair facility, and that's moved on, but we still have some training events that occur here, yeah.
And culturally, how would you define Pensacola?
Wow. The people are extremely friendly. I'm always amazed when I go back to Gilroy, and me and my brother, we're just driving around, and I'll come to a four-way intersection, and I'll wave somebody through. My And my brother will scream at me. He said, you know, you're going to get sued doing that. And I said, well, you know, it's courteous, let that guy through. He said, never do that. You know, well, not only that, when you meet somebody coming out of a store, it's always a nice smile, people very friendly. You don't see that in leather pockets of the United States.
And how about in terms of religion, spirituality, that sort of thing?
We're in the Bible Belt, so yeah, it's a lot of churches. Not as much in South Carolina, but a lot of churches. Yeah, it's a lot of family activity.
And are you an active member of a church at this moment?
I am.
And which one?
Olive Baptist.
And several members of our crew are members of Olive Baptist, and they tell me that it's, what, 10,000 folks, and on the weekend you can get easily 2,000-3,000.
Yeah, it's about right. Yeah.
Yeah. And there's
what they call it, you know, a mega church, large church.
Right. I was impressed when I went there. You know, there's athletic facilities and really good music program, and you know, it seems to me that in Pensacola the churches take on a lot of the roles that civic centers or something would up in, you know, New England.
Right, absolutely.
And I think that Joe Hoven, who is a very good musician, Ken Hoven's wife, has occasionally played music there.
Yes, she has.
And I think that the music director, the former music director, who I believe has moved to Texas, that he used to do the music for the judges' naturalization ceremonies.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, is Pensacola kind of like that sometimes, where
yeah.
everybody sort of knows everyone else?
Yeah, it is. It's kind of a small town atmosphere, yeah.
And there's gossip and...
Well, probably, sure.
Right. And do you who else, in terms of family, do you have here?
I'm married, and I have 3 children and 13 grandchildren. I hope that number's right.
And you remember the names of all 13?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sure. We do a lot. We wife cooks every Sunday, and now we're having pool parties every Sunday, so it's nice.
Popular spot. And one of your sons is pretty well known here. What's he do?
Bruce. Bruce was a Pensacola police officer for 10 years and then was a bondsman. And now he's working for Harley-Davidson. Interesting, he scared his mom and dad for years as a police officer and then a bondsman, and now he's selling Harley-Davidson and riding.
Right.
So he's
yeah, so from bad to worse to
yeah.
from the flame to the frying pan to
yeah, exactly.
To the hog. Yeah. So so there you were, you knew something about this case from local newspaper coverage, you know, you were no expert. You walked in and boom, you're on this jury. And what were your expectations of the trial? Did you have any before the trial began?
Well, I wanted to do a good job. I wanted to listen to all the evidence and to see what it was about. I was very interested in, you know, I knew he was in jail. And I just didn't quite understand what the property piece was about. So I was very curious about that. The judge allowed us to take notes, and although I couldn't read mine, but for 2 weeks I took pretty good notes. It kept me busy.
And give us an impression, because, you know, we were covering the trial and we have our own impressions from where we were sitting, but... just give us a sense of what this trial was like. I imagine it was like none other that you've ever been through.
Yeah. And, you know, I'm an administrator. I mean, I've been in the aviation business, and I understand the importance of documentation. I was trained that way in the military and in my afterlife. But I was just overwhelmed by the amount of paperwork and the means to produce witnesses. And I just thought it was just a lot of information, a lot of data, and it was almost purposely too much. That was my gut feeling about it, to be honest with you.
So let's go through some of the characters in the courtroom. So who do you remember? And, you know, if we talk about the prosecution or the defense or the judge, how would you characterize their performance? Because in some ways it was pretty theatrical.
It was, and it was in a sense. And of course, when you're going through this all day long for a couple of weeks, kind of helps you be engaged a little bit.
It was almost hypnotic.
Yeah, it was. The prosecutor, of course, she was very peppy, spring in her step, was immediately wanted to throw a document on the screen. There's no doubt that she was very familiar with what she was doing, and I don't think she thought. I think she missed a step that the members of the jury did not have. You know, this is the first exposure to this, and we kind of look at what's going on. You know, they're using the technology nowadays where they can display stuff, and but she was very aggressive about her job. She was, you know, we were getting the money's worth out of her.
Did you ever feel that in some sense that at times she seemed to jog from her desk to the judges?
She'd jump right up, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, just the physical speed that she transected. Yeah. And what were your impressions of the judge?
The judge was very professional. Would not allow me to chew gum. she had her rules and stuff. And you know, she was very good. She gave us directions at the beginning, and at the end of the trial, she came in, we could question her. You know, she was very professional.
And what about the defense attorneys?
I like both of them, Ken's attorney was kind of like a typical Southern old Andy Griffith type guy. He'd explain information to you, and somewhere along the line, he kind of put everything in a little package for you. I thought he was very smooth. Yeah.
And Klotz, who was the defense attorney for Hansen?
A smart guy. I thought he did a great job. But my peers thought that he was too shy. I kind of totally missed that piece of it.
Yeah. Did you ever find this trial a bit bizarre?
Yeah. And initially, when the fella bought the house on the internet, I was trying to put that together in my head what they were trying to show us, and I realize now, looking back over the whole thing, they were trying to show that Mr. Hovind was greedy in trying to take this guy's property away from him. I believe the guy bid on the internet for this piece of property, and the property kept coming into the scenario. They talked about electricity to the property, and this guy had this house, but they needed to use some electricity, and would he let him do that, and some other issues. I had a little difficulty with that piece of it.
In what way?
I didn't know what they were trying to, what the estate was trying to show about that event.
What about the number of people that were involved in verifying fingerprints, filings, and things like that?
I really thought that was, I thought it was all over the top. Again, this is part of my scenario where I thought a David and Goliath issue. When they brought the fingerprints into the case, I didn't quite understand that, because Hansen was called to Pensacola to do the fingerprints. Well, I mean, it's 2015. You know, who uses manual fingerprints anymore? It's all digital. They're using scanners. He's a mile or two away from a federal courthouse. Why couldn't he have done it there? And so I was a little concerned of the cost of that. And then, of course, they brought in a couple of clerks and, you know, to show that they had an envelope and they sent him something that he had already said that he did. So I thought that was just a waste of money, actually. I didn't think it was very frugal.
What was the jury like? Was there good camaraderie? Did you develop friendships? Were there some shared laughters?
Yeah, you know, one of the criteria that the judge told us was each time we adjourned was not to discuss the case, and you know, we'd get to a point where something was really interesting. I really wanted to talk to somebody about it. Of course, you couldn't do that. And so we're holding this thing in for this period of time and, you know, wanting to talk about it. There may be some hinting a little bit. What do you think about it? Nobody would answer them, you know. But I thought they did well. The head bailiff there was really a pro. He baked us cakes and treats every day. And
he was a real... Hollywood figure there. With
he was right.
His bald head. And his movements. He was quite the host.
Oh yeah, he was right on target. That guy.
Yeah, he was the old school bailiff. So, were most of the jury members from Pensacola? Were they from nearby?
No, some of them were from as far away as Crestview. So I was really surprised.
So for those of us that don't know Florida geography, how far away is Crestview?
Probably an hour and 10 minutes, something like that, down the freeway.
So towards Alabama or east?
East of us, yeah.
So how many of you were kind of, you know, Pensacola proper and knew the scene a little bit?
Of 14 of us, I think maybe two or three were outside the area. One was from Navarre, which is the Fort Walton Beach area, and one was from Crestview, as I recall.
So basically, through the rumor mill, which is never all that accurate, as the rumor mill would have it, there was 11 who wanted to convict, and one who did not. Is that more or less on target?
I can't answer that question.
Okay. Can you answer the question if it was, you know, kind of fairly evenly divided or kind of all over the place, or how would you characterize, you know, in terms of the, you know, there was quite a number of counts?
Yes.
So was it a fairly unified jury, or was there some passionate dissension? You know, without overstepping your comfort level, you know, can you give us some sense of how is a body politic?
Well, let me say this about that. We had a lawyer on the jury. She didn't no longer practice as law, but she was, you know, pretty savvy lady. And we initially, everybody made a statement about what they felt. And she was really good about keeping us on track. And, you know, actually my job as a foreman was pretty easy. I just kind of let her kind of orchestrate a little thing. I just, you know, tried to keep the riots to a minimum.
And were there riots?
No, not really. We had strong conversation the first 6 hours of deliberation. We, you know, almost immediately, everybody gave their opinion, and almost immediately there was a division, and so we said, okay, we'll go, let's go through the facts. You know, there became a debate between me and another individual with regards to what the judge ordered. And a large percentage of my peers felt that the information that we had collected was the facts of the case, and that we were to determine whether that was factual or not. And what I said was, well, yes, that's true, that's part of it. But you're also bringing in your experience and your ethnicity and, you know, life experiences. And so when you listen to somebody talk, when somebody's presenting something, you got to consider some of that in whether or not the information is accurate or not. You just can't, on the face of it, say, yes, this is a document and that's the fact of the matter.
So some people were kind of more focused on the data set and the bare facts, you know, as presented what more by the state, and others, including yourself, were a little more on the nuances of the conversations and a little more into maybe the humanity of the whole thing?
Yeah, we addressed the more serious charge first, the conspiracy charge. And I just could not see... here's a guy in prison for 10 years. Everything he says, every letter he writes, is monitored by the government. And so, you know, how could he do something that the government didn't know? It initially didn't make any sense to me. And so I kept looking at this issue of the conspiracy. Hansen and Hovind never met. They didn't know each other. You know, they didn't meet in the Waffle House and say, let's gyp the government out of this. And another thing that kept driving me crazy was, maybe because it was my government experience, I send you a form and you don't want to approve it. Well, then don't approve it. I mean, how is that a violation of the judge's order because they have some of your property and you're contesting that legally through a document and they want to put you in jail for that.
So are you kind of referring to the fraud charges there?
Yeah, the conspiracy fraud, where was that? Show me where that's at. And if you look at today's newspaper, it is very clear that somebody higher up the food chain sees that either the government didn't, the verbiage wasn't correct. I'm not exactly sure the legal issues of that, but.
So what do you mean by today's newspaper?
Well, in the last 2 days, Judge Rogers has decided, or they're looking at dismissing the case, and I think they did that today.
So is there an issue of dismissing with prejudice or without prejudice? Have you followed that?
No, not really. And, of course, you know, I'm not a rocket scientist, but I am concerned that it says the government reserves the right to retry it. They're going to change the words and do it again. I'm not exactly sure what's that.
And you're concerned because you would think it's a little ridiculous?
Yeah, I mean... we've spent a fortune on this thing. Look, they got two IRS guys. This is what they do. You know, I mean, I'd like the IRS to catch the guy that took my ID. I had the IRS write me a letter. Well, I probably shouldn't say this, but they wrote me a letter and said, Mr. Camacho, if you're interested in receiving your $1,370 credit due for your college tuition, you need to fill this paper out correctly. And so I called him up. I said, hey, this is a mistake. I'm 71 years old. I didn't do college the first 71 years. I'm certainly not going to do it right now. And they said, well, you submitted this form. I said, no, I didn't. They said, this is your Social Security number. I said, I'm telling you. And they said, did you make $34,000 last year? I said, no, I didn't. Look at my W-2. Who am I talking to? But anyways, I rant.
Right. So, what about this kind of, you know, Hollywood image of the mafia boss or the gang leader that somehow manages to get information in and out of prison so they continue to run book or continue to run a gang or continue to run organized crime from prison, you know, with little notes and gum wrappers and that kind of thing. I mean, I've done some filmmaking in prison, you know, and I've always been amazed that, you know, if I walk into the prison yard and I drop a gum wrapper, there's about, you know, 3,000 inmates within 5 minutes that know I dropped a gum wrapper. So I don't know, the idea that there can be more conspiracy that the government knew about, for me, knowing the prison environment is somewhat more plausible. And also in talking to ex-employees of Hovind's and et cetera, and understanding the way he liked to, you know, he was kind of a micromanager, meddlesome type of boss, you know, again, I can see that.
Well, but they tried to make the point that there was some documents passed, I think in South Carolina. You know, but to me, the responsibility lies on the government. I mean, they have the controls. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. It is your responsibility. So if I figure a way around that, I'm not saying anybody should do that, but the responsibility is yours. It's not the individual. I often tell my supervisors that if you let Tommy watch TV with the sailors for 30 minutes every day, this is now part of his job. I've allowed it. I can't come in one day and say, hey, you can't do that. You have changed the environment. So if in our prison systems, we're allowing people to bring in cell phones and drugs and stuff like that, we haven't got a better system, something's wrong.
Right, I understand your point. For weeks, if not months, leading up to the trial, the blogosphere and the internet was full of opinions and social media, and a lot of that was generated by the conspiracy theorists who kind of glommed around this issue. And to a certain extent, it appeared that the defendant responded to that kind of attention, thought maybe it would help his case. And there were some very colorful characters. There were threats against the judge, the prosecutor. There was a lot of, you know, they poked fun at the journalists. You know, basically anyone who wasn't of their ilk. They were very passionate and they were very prolific. Did any of that filter in to you all as jurors?
Yes, it was. It was very disappointing to walk into the federal courthouse and have the protesters that were, by the way, mostly from out of state. If you look at their tags, Colorado, South Carolina, you know, yelling at you, you know. And matter of fact, I shared that with a friend of mine just recently. I said that bothered me that, you know, the judge did a great job with the security issue. You know, when we left the last day, we went out her chambers, and you can't see that from anywhere. And so they had security guys all over the place. In the morning when we came in and parked, they had security walk us into the courthouse. And I don't think anybody felt threatened from that, but it was, I could tell that it didn't bother me so much. I'm used to the guys yelling on the street corner, and I kind of like, hey, you know, that's good stuff. Right. Let me turn down my Christian music. What does he say?
Egg him on a little bit. So are you saying you weren't like concerned for your safety, but it was a little bit offensive, annoying, alienating?
Yeah, I know it would polarize some of my peers. I knew that it would do that.
So I'm asking, I'm not telling you, would you characterize it as counterproductive?
Absolutely. 100% counterproductive.
So were some of the jurors, do you think, less inclined to show Hovind and Hansen leniency because of the behavior of the protesters?
I think that it was part of the effect. I agree. And, you know, the prosecutor's closing statements, she said, this was about greed. This is a greedy man. And we had a great debate about that. And I kept saying, are you kidding? This guy's not driving a Mercedes-Benz and living in a mansion. You know, this guy had a, this is a one-man evangelical program when he started out. He's one guy. And, you know, he's going 33 countries and preaching the word. He had a good presentation, scientific, to counter the evolutionists. And man, he went away. He probably did some stupid things. I'm not so sure about the first trial. The judge quieted him when he tried to tell us about it. But what I could ascertain from it was they were taking less than $10,000 out of, they were taking their $10,000, less than $10,000, out of the bank to keep the IRS, which was a drug thing, a ruling to make sure you couldn't run drug money around. But he did that a bunch of times, and that violated IRS law.
Didn't he also not pay his personal taxes?
Yeah, and I don't really understand what that was. Probably, some silly stuff. Look, I was in the early 90s a member of the Escambia Militia. This is pre...
What's the Escambia Militia?
It was a group of men who were patriots, mostly retired military, that felt... that were strong in the Second Amendment, and we felt that states' rights were sometimes violated by the federal government. We weren't happy that Florida National Guard was sent overseas to fight a war when their primary purpose was to support the people of Florida. You know, the hurricanes, other issues that we see. But it was nationalized, and, we understand that. But I had some pretty wacko buddies. There's guys all over the spectrum of that. And you talked about the conspiracy stuff, you know. I had a guy call me from South Florida regularly. He said, hey, there's a black helicopter following me, and I'm ducking in this canyon, and... And I said, yeah, okay, that's really good. I've had guys tell me, hey, you know, I'm burying my guns in my backyard. So, well, that's a real good idea. So, you know.
Yeah, so the type of person, particularly Hansen, was, because I think he's a little closer to that sovereign citizen.
Probably.
Conspiracy theory. Yeah. That was not new for you.
No, but, I mean, I get the point where he had some legal... information for Mr. Hovind. However, you probably shouldn't have listened to him.
So you know, one of the things that I found the most baffling was when they talked about the trust. You know, and I was asking Klotz about this. But I mean, like, so Hansen, like, you were told what to do by the trust members, but you don't know their names. Do you remember that part?
Oh, yeah.
Of the trust? I mean, that was part of, that was probably when I was like, when my jaw really began to drop.
Well, and this is probably a local thing. Well, when I'm saying local thing, you probably see it more in the Bible Belt. We have lots of little churches, okay? Lots of them. And I've been a member of a real small church. And so in a small church, you have a piece of property. And, you know, you have a pastor that you bring in, but he is not in charge of the property. So they usually have Mr. and Mrs. Jones who's been there. You know, they got their
right, so
family
they got,
buried.
They have the continuity. Yeah. You pastors might come and go.
Yeah. They sign the trust. You know, they're responsible for the property. You know, they pay the taxes and that kind of stuff. It's just really common. You see them all over the place. Now, legally, do they really know what they're doing? Probably not. You know, and that's what I saw with him. When they started passing the the trust, this guy's a trust, this guy, you know.
Glenn Stoll.
And... Well, even, yeah, and I questioned Hovind when he said, who's a pretty dynamic guy. This is not a guy that gives you the keys, by the way. This is a leader that's out in front, right? And he makes you the trustee and then tells you what to do. That's not the way it's supposed to work. But I saw that several times. And it, to this day, they got a trustee. They don't know where he's at. I don't remember his name right now, but he's out there somewhere. I think they think he's in Washington State.
Glenn Stoll.
Yeah.
Who likes to start ministerial trusts for different, like, taxi drivers and hot dog stand sellers, and, you know, turn them all into churches. So when you said that you mentioned to a friend that some of the protests were a bit obnoxious, or those are my words, not yours.
Yeah, this is a Christian friend of mine.
Yeah, so is it someone who's connected to the Hovinds of the family, or
no?
Or just you were just remarking on it?
Yeah.
So on the subject of Christianity, why didn't we see more support for the defendant from
mainline churches?
Well, like yours, like Olive Baptist or Marcus Point or PCC, the Christian College. You know, you remarked that most of the protesters were from out of town, and I would say just about all of them, because we talked to them and have, you know, followed their postings on the internet and stuff like that. So given that Pensacola is a, you know, has more Christians than atheists or anything else, given that Pensacola, you know, has a history since the Brownsville revival of some, you know, pretty colorful movements and a strong anti-abortion movement, et cetera, why wasn't there some wellspring of local support, either from the leadership of the churches, the educational institutions, the general public? Where was the break?
Well, I think initially, I think most people initially thought that his income tax issue that he went to prison for, he paid his time for, was probably meant well, but was really bad advice. And he started to tell us, he started to fill me in on the real story, and maybe I've manufactured some, I'm not exactly sure. But he talked about when he first started, he had a pastor down the road, I don't remember what the church was now. But the pastor gave him some advice and said,
you right know, on the 501c3.
501c3, yeah. The issue is in the pulpit, and this is a growing issue now, do you want the government to tell you what to say, right? And so if you argue with the government, then the government's going to take away your tax exempt status. It's a big deal for a lot of churches. He said, I'm not paying any taxes. You know, these people are, from what I understand, he hired young men and women from PCC, Pensacola Christian, and he paid them as missionaries. This is a love offering, which is a common, it's a common thing. If you come in and sing in my church, we give you a love offering. You come and talk. And
me?
Yeah.
Okay. How much am I worth as a baritone?
Baritone. Oh, yeah. Baritone's a dime a dozen. It's the sopranos we would like to get. Yeah. But that tax exempt status is it was an issue with him, and so he got some bad advice. He wouldn't have been the first friend of mine. You know, I had a good doctor, a hero, a Silver Star grunt marine. He was a corpsman, you know, got shot in Vietnam, got out of the Marines, went to school, became a Navy doctor, a flight surgeon right here, really patriot, went to prison for income tax evasion. Looked me in the eye one Thursday night when we were having pancakes and saying, are you willing to go to prison and give up your retirement for your beliefs? And I shrunk in my chair, you know, because the some of those things was wrong. You can't write on your W-2, I'm not paying taxes. I mean, right. You know, you got to put some common sense to that thing. But
the aspects of the sovereign citizen movement, like where they say, you know, we're going to do our own licenses, our own driver's license.
Yeah, I got,
You know, and Hansen saying, you know, I don't recognize, I'm not a citizen of the United States. I don't, you know, all that thing about jurisdiction and residency and driver's licenses. Where did that leave you?
I just never could wrap my hands around that. And I've always been a taxpayer, you know, been working since I'm 17. I don't get that piece of it.
I mean, what about the fact that also as a former military man, the bulk of taxes or the majority of taxes goes for the military, doesn't it?
Sure.
So when these guys don't want to pay taxes, did that ever cross your mind in terms of, like, you know, what they're protesting against? Or?
Well, again, I've never had any. Look, if you want a nice road and you want some nice lighting and you want some protection from the police, and you have to pay for those things, you know. So I've never had any problem with it.
Okay, but still that same question. So was it just because Hovind was in jail for a long time and he was forgotten? Was it because maybe people didn't want to risk being audited or looked at themselves? Did Hovind have what was his reputation? You know, did people think he was a little overbearing or something? I mean,
I think most people stood away, those individuals that you mentioned earlier, because, you know, this was a lightning rod, so to speak. So you didn't hear anybody, you know, talk about saying, hey, look, he's paid his price. Of course, nobody knew the facts of the conspiracy fraud issue until it came out in the court. And I think now some folks are taking a better look at it and say, hey, wait a minute, maybe we're wrong. I can't tell you how many times in my life I've said stuff and I'm totally against the grain. And I was right. Not that I'm smart at all. Maybe I'm just lucky sometimes. I don't know.
What do you mean by that?
You just have to stand up. It's almost like a movement that you see this wrong. Not treating everybody fair. Maybe this is part of my California heritage.
You mean in terms of the state's accusations? I'm a little lost.
So. Yeah, I was really inundated with this power of the United States against this guy who's in prison. This guy who's got a box, you know, all his things is in a box, and they won't even give him his box.
Referring to the South Carolina, the Bivens.
Yeah, part of it, and yeah. They thought it was, here's a white Southern Baptist, not Southern Baptist, but a a white Baptist preacher. Let's stick a black guy in a cell, see how he likes that for a while. And Hovind said, hey, they meant to do me bad, but it turned out good. Because the guy was a genius. And what's kind of interesting, that'd be a nice little story, a conversation between those two guys.
Right. That was an interesting, again, sort of a made-for-TV movie kind of friendship.
Yeah. Well, here's two guys surviving.
Yeah.
Now, who's the bad guy? The man.
Yeah. So do you think Hovind was a racist?
No, I never saw anything that led me to believe that. However, he made one statement that kind of grinched me a little bit when he said something to the effect where he couldn't turn him white. Did you remember that? I said, man, that's not good.
Yeah.
That's not going to fly too well.
Yeah, maybe you shouldn't say that.
Yeah.
Now, were you aware that, again, in this barrage of social media and commentary, you know who Rudy Davis is?
I know of him.
Yeah. Did you ever watch any of his video clips?
Mm-hmm.
So during the trial, did anyone in the jury mention having gone online and seen all this lively debate?
No, I don't think so.
And would that have been allowed?
Oh no,
yeah.
No. You could. We weren't allowed to look at the newspaper. Matter of fact, when I do digital stuff, when we finished the trial, I went home and took a look at what was going on, the background there. And I saw one of his videos. It was interesting. Matter of fact, I went to 2 Peter 3 because he'd mentioned it so many times. I never heard of it before. I got to go up there. What in the world is this about?
Because it was, you know, that's what's interesting. You know, we were so inundated with that stuff.
Yeah.
And it was my first experience, really. Like, you know, I was never particularly that. I'm a journalist and a filmmaker, and I'm not interested so much in blogs and this and that. But there was such a volume. You know, the defenders of Hovind, those that were critical. I mean, there was so much, and you know, they were fond of calling. You know, Rudy Davis would say that the prosecutor's skirts were too tight, and someone else suggested that it might be a good idea if you know someone took out the judge.
Oh my God!
You know, and that's why there was so much security there. You know, I mean, you know, we saw it, you know, coming in. There was a lot of federal marshals, and I think a lot of that had to do with the hullabaloo of these folks.
Did you follow the mold issue in the building?
The mold issue?
Yeah.
I was not at all aware of that until I got notice up in Boston that we might be going to a different courthouse because to me, what we saw was, you know, a really good sound system, really good graphic displays, a nice clean waiting room, you know, freshly painted and
yeah.
Nicely carpeted.
Me too. Matter of fact, my company has 5 workers there, custodial workers, okay? So a day or two after the trial, and this mold thing pops up, I'm reading this, and she says this place...
Who is she?
Rogers. Okay, Rogers is poking... It's 2 government agencies. You want to talk about some struggle... GSA, you know who they are?
Mm-hmm.
Huh? It's a bunch of old white guys down in Philadelphia that's been there since the 1700s, and they got all the money in the world. I mean, you talk about the mafia, the GSA, are you kidding me? Our local representative says, I'm going to Washington, and I'm going to change GSA, and I'm thinking, this guy is crazy. I mean, are you kidding me? But look, she said the building... is not healthy, okay? I'm a safety expert, okay? I'm totally aware of the OSHA's general duty clause, which says, as a supervisor, you cannot put your workers in harm. It's a violation, general duty clause, the very first one out of the chute. So I said, I've got 5 workers there. They're working in an area where the judge says it's dangerous. the mold's a big issue. Maybe you want to do a story on that one day. She knows that it's dangerous. She said it was dangerous. It was unhealthy. And she summons me to court knowing that. She violated the general duty clause. So the second day that the article came out, I called OSHA. I said, hey, I have a complaint. What's the problem? I talked to the duty officer in the Jacksonville office. And I says, this local court judge summoned me to court knowing it was a bad mold in the building. And they said, no, mold's not a problem. There's no PEL level of exposure. It's perfectly fine. But I wanted to poke it.
Who was most effective at reaching the jury?
Probably the prosecutor.
And why?
That is a really good question. I don't know. It mystifies me, to be perfectly honest. It's almost like I wasn't there. I don't know. I think because they believed everything she said. And, I mean, she gave a lot of facts, but there just wasn't any logic behind that process. That's the issue that I had.
So who reached you the best?
Oh, that old lawyer. He was smooth.
And by smooth, what do you mean?
He presented well. He wasn't rattled, and he just told it. He said right from the beginning, you're going to have a lot of documents, you know, but you won't find conspiracy anywhere. I mean, that's right out of the chute. That's true from day one. The rest of it was kind of like a circus.
So I want to go back to the group called the Hovindicators. That's the press term for them that they've now eagerly adopted.
Right.
And this is sort of personal for me, but they kind of went, you know, I wasn't really impacted or affected by folks who were demonstrating in the street, and you know, no one was yelling at me because I wasn't a juror. But, you know, they, in their blogs, their radio shows and things like that, you know, they mentioned members of my crew by name, you know, who happened to be good Christian Baptists. And I was raised by a mom and two sisters. And so when Hovind, you know, allows people to be his spokespeople who are, you know, making threatening remarks about people in court and you know, calling them Jezebels and, you know, so on and so forth.
Right.
That offends me.
Sure.
And when people go after me, I don't care. When people go after my crew members,
sure,
you know, who are basically just doing their job or, you know, in for the experience, that really offends me.
Sure.
You know, so, you know, kind of what the creepy factor for me is that, you know, that Hovind not only takes bad advice, but it just seems like, you know, he's the type of guy that lets, you know, he gets the mad dog, he lets other people be the mad dog for him, and he can be like Bill Nye the Science Guy. And I find, you know, Hovind's early, you know, teachings, you know, funny and lively and, you know, good rhetorical, you know, presentations. I've enjoyed watching them. I like his son, Eric.
Eric's a nice young man.
Really, you know, really straight up guy. But it's, you know, that bothers me, you know, the Hansons and the Stolls and the Rudy Davises and the, you know, these other extreme fringe, you know, loudmouths. It just, you know, so as a practicing Christian or Baptist, you know, over 50 as you are, and you know, and probably a little more time to think about spiritual issues, how does that sit with you? And you know, first of all, I mean, the Vindicators will tell you that this is about Christian persecution. Did you feel that the IRS and the state would not have gone after the defendant so vigorously if he wasn't a religious man? In other words, is the Christian persecution thing, does it have some basis in truth for you?
Possibly. I mean, I see a rationale. But you know, you have a plethora of friends sometimes. And you know, like I told you when I was a the militia guy, I had some that were way out there. I mean, way out there. And I had some that were dead, you know, right on. And I try to communicate with everybody. And I just don't follow the, you know, those guys that are the extremists. And I think, I don't think that Ken had the platform to have much control. Again, he's been in this little room for 10 years, so I don't know how that's affected him. I don't know how that will affect him in the future. And certainly, some of the radical folks, I just don't pay attention. Look, I stopped watching the news years ago. I don't watch it, okay? I mean, I know what's going on. I'll scan the internet, and I got papers that I read. But I don't listen to the guy that says, cure for cancer, news at 10. And you go, and if you know the answer to cancer, why don't you tell me right now? News at 10. You know, it's old Barnum and Bailey throwing that little hook out there to get you come in. And then the talking heads, they're, I don't want anybody's opinion. I don't want to listen to the president and then have five people tell me what I already heard or what they thought he heard. Was heard. I don't have anything to do with it. I believe the sovereignty of God. He's in control. I mean, you tell me the world's going to end tomorrow. It may, and it may not. But God's still in control. I mean, I don't have any control over that.
Do you think that there was, you know, were you surprised when he was acquitted of the charges and the case was dismissed?
I was.
You were expecting a retrial.
I am. as a matter of fact, this is one of the...
You still are?
Yes. I'm apprehensive that it's over and he can go home and start a new life. Because I think he's paid his price.
So you think there's a possibility that they're going to pull the plug again?
Yeah, I'm a little skeptical to that. After reading the little tag at the end of the paper, 2 days in a row, that same kind of thing. I would think it would be foolish, but I think the judge I don't want to say. Sorry.
Okay. Okay, we'll put it down as unmentionable. Do you think that there was God's hand in what happened in the last couple of days in terms of the charges being dropped?
Well, again, I believe in the sovereignty of God, so he allows certain things, and you know, I'll have reasons for why he does and doesn't. Obviously, he had something to do with it. Now,
in other words, I'm asking, like, you know, when you heard the news,
I was surprised.
But did you also say, you know, this was a miracle, or you know, something to that?
No, extent? What I said was, finally, you know, somebody with a brain's looking at this. So somebody up, you know, obviously higher than the judge's office. I don't know if it was a political issue or what. But look, this does build that case. You know what ended the militia movement?
Mm-mm.
Oklahoma. And, of course, there was a conspiracy thing saying, hey, you know, the feds did that. I got buddies. You drop an airplane in the water, and my buddy will tell you that, you know, the government shot that puppy down, you know. And I don't listen to those people. They drive me crazy. The sky is falling.
So what is Oklahoma having, you know, and the number of deaths and all that, having kind of put a damper on that movement? How are you making a parallel here?
Well, again, it's a history, okay? You remember Ruby Ridge?
Yeah.
Do you remember Waco?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, the militia movement moved out because of Waco issue. You know, the sheriff of that county had the responsibility as a peacekeeper of that county, and he gave it over to the feds. That really upset a lot of people. That threw some flame into the militia movement. We're going, wait a minute, states' rights. The federal government does not have the right to come into your area where you have a official who was voted in to be the peacemaker, and he turns it over to the feds? Are you crazy? You know, that was a problem. So the Patriot movement started. We start saying, well, you know, eventually we're going to have to take care of ourselves. And with the Oklahoma bombing thing, it looked like maybe the feds had something to do with that. And so they introduced the Patriot Act. And we just kind of went underground, more or less, with that. There's still some movements around here, but look, it's all that I don't trust the government. And what you see with the Hovind situation, to me, you're looking at a guy that's been in jail for 10 years and under a microscope, and I'm gonna send him to jail for the rest of his life because he had a conspiracy in the open to defraud the government out of his own property. It's not government money we're talking about, it's his. So you get a little cynical, you keep going, what?
But if you look at this case as some kind of watershed, like Oklahoma or Ruby Ridge, what lesson do you think John Q. Public is going to take from this case, those who, you know, paid attention? Do you think that that Hovind has been, you know, like vindicated, or I mean, what do you think is the bigger picture here? Because, you know, it's pretty unusual that that the federal government will invest that much in this kind of trial, and then, you know, can you imagine? You know, you were there and I was there. Can you imagine that trial on instant replay? Can you imagine the energy that those three attorneys would have to expend to do it over again? Can you imagine
that? Well, yeah. No. As a matter of fact, I often wondered about that. Matter of fact, I lamented over, you know, I sat in a trial. I have some information to share. You know, if I would do this again, maybe you need to tell the protesters to get out. They're not helping you, not helping your issue. You know, I'd say number one. Number two, I'd say, hey, look, her whole point was he was greedy.
Which her?
The prosecutor. Her whole point, he was greedy. So I would make the case that from the very onset, that this is a holy man, you know, who gave his money away. You know, he's not the sheikh, you know, of Pensacola. You know,
and what about Hansen? Did Klass was remarking on this, and I was remarking on this. Hansen was never a person to me. You know, he was like, and I think that's partly the fault of his attorney and partly just because the way he is. He was a guy who kind of sat on the side of the courtroom, kind of doing something with his hands, rocking back and forth.
I know.
and who read the encyclopedia wall to wall when he was 12 years old, who ran his family farm.
Smarter than everybody in the court.
Smarter than everybody in the world.
Yeah.
Did you feel like this guy had friends? Did you feel that he was a three-dimensional character? I mean, to me, you know, I'm a journalist and a filmmaker, and I'm trying to get a beat on the guy, and he was like a cartoon character.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I'm asking this question because, you know, we're often wondering, what's the jury seeing? I mean, you have a different perspective. You're getting different information. You're allowed to take notes. I mean, we were as the press, but you're allowed to take notes. You're reading documents. You know, how did you experience this case in a way that was different than the observers? And when you were looking across the room and you saw the observers there, what was your impression there as well? Because, I mean, aside from us, I mean, literally the three or four of us, along with a guy from the Pensacola News Journal, they're all Hovan supporters in that courtroom, except for staff, and they're all, you know, except for maybe one or two from out of state.
Well, you know, I was curious, because I was sitting there trying to discern who was whom, you know, who's, you know, was his wife, and, you know, I've never met her. You know, I was trying to figure, was that his grandchildren, his children, who was who that was coming in? And I knew there were some press people there, but. Look, Hanson, yeah, I had a hard time with him. Because I know, you know, probably not guys as smart as he was, but I know guys with that same kind of deal. I don't have a driver's license. I got a paper to prove it. Well, I'm going to have to Google how you could even do that. Well, why would you, you know, he just stuck in the wrong time period.
So, again, I'm going to ask the question. So was this a case or in part of Christian prosecution? Was it just the federal government overstepping its bounds? And what do you think is going to be the impact on Pensacola? So, you know, not necessarily directly, but you have, like, you know, you had the abortion clinic bombings.
Yes.
You know, you had, you have the new kind of economic engine in Pensacola. You know, the guys are trying to build up the downtown and
baseball park.
Yeah, the baseball Stewart. Park and so like that. So you have these different phenomena going on. And did the Hovind trial, like, kind of take you back to the old days, or you know, where does it fit in, like, the spectrum of, you know, so when we have the Whitey Bulger case or something in Boston, you know, it's like, you know, for those of us who kind of grew up, you know, in the shadow of the tough guys and the maid guys and the mafia, you know, that trial kind of brought that back for us.
Right.
You know, so, I mean, how did it feel for you as a transplanted but long-term Pensacolan, and, you know, also, you know, in terms of, like, has there been talk, you know, from the pulpit? And Olive, and I ask, you know, you guys that question too, you know, is it part of the consciousness? Is there an object lesson here? That's what I'm asking you, Doug. Mm.
Well, you know, I boiled the whole case down to the government, again, the David and Goliath piece. I didn't see the persecution of the church. I understand it from, you know, talking to brothers and sisters about it. Some feel that way, not many, but some feel that way. This is a classic example of separation of church and state. And, you only got to go to the back of the Bible. You go back to the book of Revelations. It tells you how it ends, you know. So you don't have to sit here and say the doomsday stuff. You can take a quick look back there in the 23rd chapter. But I just think that I felt that it was just too much for the federal government. I just thought it was a big guy picking on a little guy. That's how I saw it, the case.
And as a career naval officer and you know, how did that affect your view of the case? you know, that level of bureaucracy and kind of thing, which I know that you experienced also in the military.
Well, I think to me it was important in character, do the right thing, regardless of, you know, what you're being told. I stayed by my gun. Do the right thing. What was the right thing to do?
As a jury member?
Yes, sir. And as the foreman, you know, I was given this. It's kind of funny that almost immediately, you know, we said first business, and this one lady says that he'd make a good foreman. Everybody said, "Oh yeah," and I looked at him. I says, "You're going to regret this," which they did. It was a good group of people, good citizens. I think they did their duty, like they were called to do.
And again, without violating any kind of ethics or code here, would you consider yourself on the majority side or the dissenting side?
Dissenting side.
And did that leave you frustrated, or was it just sort of, I mean, like afterwards and stuff, did it, you know, or was it just kind of part of the circumstances?
You know, being an officer, I was as a high school dropout. I went through 8 enlisted ranks, 3 chief warrant officer ranks, and 3 commissioned officer ranks. And I learned to work, especially as an officer. You know, my peers were Notre Dame graduates. Guy from, I had a roommate that was a physicist from NYU. You know, and I went to 2 years of high school. These were really brilliant young men, and aviators to boot. And I was a guy that worked on airplanes. And, what I learned was the character was really important. I grew up in the military. My dad was 39 when I was 6 years old, and he died from drinking out of a bottle that surrounded by a paper bag. Cirrhosis of the liver. But the military gave me, I was fortunate. And if you want to see God's hand, I was put for the most part, with good supervisors that give me good skills, and that was really important to me. And I can't remember why I'm telling you that.
Because you started by saying, you know, it's about character.
Yeah.
So are you saying it's about the that you felt that you acted as a member of the jury and as the foreman of the jury, with ethics and character, or are you saying that,
I think everybody did for their experience and their background, of course.
Why can't we know who hung the jury? Because you're not the type to kiss and tell, or because?
Well, no, I think the judge gave us a direction. You have a constitutional right to give your opinion about the evidence. But the numbers, there's 2 reasons. And I think she said you could not tell what the number scenario was, number one. And the other reason, the case is not over.
Do you really think it's not over? Or, charges drop, case dismissed.
Well, I hope so. I mean, I really hope so. I hope so from.
No, but what's your gut?
I still don't know what the trick in the bag is. You know what I mean? I'm hoping that I'll pull out a joker somewhere along the line.
Are you surprised that maybe it seemed like the judge and the prosecutor kind of went different ways last weekend?
Yeah, that is. That really surprised me. Absolutely surprised me. Absolutely. I thought from the very beginning that the judge had such a fat head. When I tell you to do something, you do it. She wouldn't let me chew gum, so maybe I was. No, I knew she was a lady by the rules, you know, and I knew her from other cases that I've read in the paper, stuff like that. And she's pretty straight, you know. And I just thought she got a little bit too much power and said, no, like the deal with Hanson, you're coming to Pensacola because I said so. And I'm thinking, how much is that going to cost? I mean, I'm kind of like a frugal guy with government money. I'm not frugal with my own, but I am with government money. It's
so the fact that she and Eggers didn't seem to be on the same page with this, wasn't that a little bit shocked? I mean, I came down to cover a trial. I got, you know, some caretaking help for my son. You know, I had exactly the right number of socks. You know, I was prepared to ride it out.
Sure.
I was not expecting that Eggers and Rogers would be going in different directions.
I'd love to know what this formula is. I'm thinking there's a real old Supreme Court judge somewhere that took Rogers in her hand and said, hey, look, you know, this is going to appeal, and you're not going to do well. You're not going to do well.
Well, I
don't know that.
The Hovindicators, it's a possibility. But the Hovindicators, you know, say they went out and hired some expert lawyers or United States Justice Foundation, and they advised, Thomas Keith, and there was some language, you know, at the last minute. You know, we've been looking on PACER at the orders coming in. You know, so this can't be good for Tiffany Eggers.
No, you're probably right. Well, you know, I kept saying all along, and if you talk to his son is what it said it was. Just my dad, and not that there's a rift. There is no rift. These two love each other. But, I think the son would say, you know, my dad's got some wacko lawyer legal advice. That's not a hidden thing. And just like I told you, I got some friends that are really, really out there. But the deal was, he ran out of money. You know, I do workers' compensation for my company. Okay, so I deal with lawyers all the time. The lawyers like to call me up, but then I'm on the meter. I mean, I used to think that these are really friendly guys. Well, he's running up the charge. You know, they charge. And, you know, they had to make a living, but he just ran out of money. So he's going to whoever he can to get some of it's really strange.
Yeah, that's a good point. So, final question. You're expecting me to keep prying on this hung jury thing, right?
Right.
I mean, would that be, you know, character with a good New York journalist? Should I keep asking you if you hung the jury?
No. It's not about me.